there's no clouds in the sky, and the sparrow can't fly, if that isn't love, then heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this.
Would take your Bibles, turn to the book of Galatians, Galatians chapter 1, verse 6. Next week we'll go back to Thessalonians, but because of what happened at the state fair, I'm going to teach tonight. I think this will be a blessing to you. We'll start out Galatians chapter 1, verse 6. Paul says, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that calleth you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. Let's open a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this night. We thank you for the opportunity to teach your word. Father, I pray now it would be the hidden man of the heart, that I would teach all things correctly and clearly, that your saints could understand and be edified, that people would understand the gospel and be saved. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. All right, now we were at the fair, and a lady come by who was a member of the Seventh-day Adventist group, and so she was asking me questions about the Sabbath. And of course, they want to keep the Sabbath. And I gave her a few answers and a few things. And so tonight's Bible study is to deal with that. I haven't taught on that in a long time. And I'll show you what the problem is and also explain some things of why I say some of the things I say from many years of experience. Now, what you need to know is this, and I think most of you do. A truly saved Christian in the Lord Jesus Christ, after he or she is saved, can receive unsound doctrine and they will still be saved. Once you're saved, correctly and biblically saved, the devil can't send you to hell. Now, he can hinder your testimony. He can do a lot to you as a Christian. But once you're saved, you're always saved. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 9, it says, if we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God which he has testified of his Son. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself, and he that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Now, this is a passage of Scripture that's extremely clear that I use a lot when I'm dealing with lost folks and trying to lead people to Christ, because it lays it out in as clear as any place in the Scriptures. He that hath the Son hath life. He that hath not the Son hath not life. No ifs, ands, buts, or arguments. That's the way it is. Now, the eternal security of the born-again saved child of God is eternally secure. That's a good thing, but there's more to everything that takes place. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. But here's what you need to understand, and I'm not trying to split hairs, this is just the way it is. If a lost soul receives a false doctrine that will add to or diminish from the simplicity of the gospel, the Lord Jesus Christ, that false doctrine will damn his soul to hell, keeping him from trusting Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior by grace through faith. This is what you need to understand. The Bible is very clear. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. When a person's saved, you can only be saved by grace through faith. If you have something that you want to believe in besides the shed blood of Jesus Christ, you're going to damn your soul to hell. You cannot get saved by trusting in something else, the gospel plus or the gospel minus. It has to be the gospel exact. That's as clear as you're ever going to get in the Word of God. And the reason for it is, a person then has not truly repented and truly put their faith in Jesus Christ. An illustration, and I like to use illustrations when I lead people to the Lord, and a good illustration that I use is a chair, because it shows putting your total faith in Jesus Christ. And I explain to people, the chair has a purpose. Jesus Christ died on Calvary's cross for a purpose. There was a reason for his going to the cross. And this chair was made to hold my entire weight, body, and being. And I can know all about this chair and not be using the chair for its purpose. I can learn that this chair is black and red. I can even look at it and believe to a reasonable point that it'd hold me. But this chair has not held me until I commit my entire weight and being to it. This is what's required for true salvation. When you commit your entire being and weight to that chair, now the chair is doing what it should. That's what real repentance is. Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. I'm not going to trust in anything but what you did on Calvary's cross, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. It's repentance and faith, plus nothing, minus nothing. Now, if you take away from the chair, say the chair had to have four legs. So if you take away something, like say I took one of the legs away, if I sat in that chair, it'd collapse and fall. And so if you take away from the gospel, well, I don't have to repent. I don't have to put my full trust in Christ. You're not getting saved. Same thing is if you add to it. I just try to give you something very, just a little thing to it. If I decide to add to it, like keeping the Sabbath, well, if you put yourself a little thing here, I don't have anything to stabilize it, and you go sit on that, it isn't going to work, see? You can't add to it. Salvation is by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ alone. There is no other name given under heaven, whereas by men must be saved. All right? So what you need to realize, this is why it's very important to have correct doctrine. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. It's a gift. Another illustration that I use is anything I have on me, and I tell them and say, look, this is mine, I own it, I possess it. And it's not yours, even if I offer it to you, unless you take it and receive it, and it transfers from me to you. Then the gift is yours. Another one I use, a good illustration, is I use a man that's hanging over a precipice, and the rocks are 1,000 feet below, and he's hanging on the rope to keep himself from dropping off to his destruction. And suddenly the angel of the Lord appears and says, dost thou believe I can save thee? And oh, yes, my God, yes, please save me, save me. Let go of the rope. That shows total faith and trust. Now, that's why people have a hard time getting saved. How simple is it to let go of the rope? It's the simplest thing in the world. You just go. But fear or pride or other human emotions can keep you from doing what you need to do. Most people will end up going to hell from either fear or pride. They're afraid to put their total trust in Jesus Christ. They don't sit about and pray about it and ask God. I mean, there is no other name given under heaven. So if Jesus Christ can't save you, nothing can save you, so you might as well trust him. But fearful heart. That's why the Bible says the fearful and unbelieving. See? They're condemned to hell. And pride. Well, I want to do something so that everybody will give me respect. You know, I want God's going to owe me. No, it's a gift. For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is a gift, not of works. And here's the reason. God's not going to have his creation boasting. Well, I was the best soul winner out there, Lord. I was the best. I was not of works, lest any man should boast. However, if a Christian embraces false doctrine to add some form of works to salvation after their salvation, they themselves cannot lose their salvation, having received eternal life previous to their corruption. Yet they will be responsible for the damning of the souls of those who receive a false gospel from them. The gospel of Jesus Christ is very clear that no form of works will ever work in this age for salvation. Now that's why I've taught you one of the great Christian heresies is Calvinism. And from the best that I can determine, the underlying heart root problem is human pride of a Christian that and laziness of a Christian that doesn't want to fight the good fight, that doesn't want to be faithful to the Lord and receive and live through the offense of the cross. And so as to subdue his guilt-ridden conscience for infidelity to the Lord, Christians have developed this big heresy where a lot of saved Christians flock into Calvinistic churches so they can walk like Christians, supposedly talk like Christians, act like Christians, and never do the work of a Christian. It won't send them to hell. The sad thing is, though, it'll send everybody else to hell that will buy into that false doctrine. Because the Calvinistic Christ is not the biblical Christ. If any other man preach on any other gospel, Paul said, let him be accursed. Now the issue, this is why I tell you, I don't know who's saved and who's lost, because I cannot discern the heart. The issue is, people tell me all kinds of things. The issue is, and God's going to have to make the decision, the person should know. Were you trusting in your works plus Christ, and now you're telling everybody you're saved by grace? You're going to hell. Did you truly repent and trust Christ by grace, and then you picked up false teaching afterwards? Well, you're going to heaven, but you're going to mess up everybody else that you're dealing with. You see? It's time and judgment. That's why I've taught you over and over and over and over and over and over again. All life is contingent on time and judgment. Galatians chapter 2, verse 11. But when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face, because he was to blame. Now here's a saved man. Peter had been converted. He's been preaching the gospel. He's even learned from Paul of the gospel for us today, as he was going first to the circumcision. Now he did learn it from Paul. He learned it from his own experiences with Cornelius and God opening up his eyes to salvation by grace through faith. And other, I can't spend the whole night on the book of Acts with Paul, with Peter, I mean. But you should understand what I'm talking about. But now after being saved, after knowing the truth, and after leading Cornelius to the Lord and other folks and being the apostle to the circumcision, he picks up some false doctrine due to the weakness of his flesh. For before that certain came of James, he did eat with the Gentiles. But when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision. Now that's why the Bible tells you the fear of man bringeth a snare. Peter is fearing the circumcision. He's fearing his standing before those individuals. So now he's going to dissimulate. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas was also carried away with their dissimulation. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all. Now watch how Peter straightens, watch how Paul straightens Peter out. He doesn't do it telling him he's a jerk and, you know, the way that many of the brethren like to do it. He did it in grace. If thou being a Jew, livest after the manner of the Gentiles, and that's what Peter was doing, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? Now, Peter's in a quandary there. We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified, watch this, by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. Now, if you teach front up that your salvation is in any ways contingent upon your keeping the Sabbath, you're damning people to hell, because you cannot be saved by the works of the law. And that's what keeping the Sabbath would be. It would be a part of the works of the law. In fact, it has to do with the Jews and their covenant. We'll see that in a few moments. So this lady came up to me, and she was asking me questions. And I don't know if they were genuine or not. I'm going to try to send her this Bible study to answer her questions. All right? She has been attending some other churches that are not Seventh-day Adventist, so perhaps she is really searching the truth. Because she was asking me about things, and she wasn't a standard positioned Seventh-day Adventist that you've got to keep the Sabbath to go to heaven. She was saying, no, for by grace you're saved. Keeping the Sabbath has nothing to do with getting saved. Okay. Now here's the thing, though. If she's trusting in that Sabbath, and she's never repented of her sins and totally trusted Christ by faith, she's going to hell. Now if she got saved by faith completely, and she's picked up incorrect doctrine, she's saved, but she's going to harm others. Now she says she's saved. This is why I tell you can't tell if a person's saved now. You can teach sound doctrine, but for me, a person that thinks they know who's saved and lost, I just don't agree with them. I don't know how you could tell who's saved and lost if you can't see the heart and the conditions for salvation. It's a spiritual thing. Now, God knows. God knows. The devil knows. And you know. Because you know what you've done. You know if you're standing on the scriptures and on the blood. I'll go by what you tell me. Now, she told me she's saved, so I'm not going to tell her she's not. She said, I was saved by grace through faith plus nothing. Okay. I hope she is. I'm not her enemy. But if you, a Gentile, live after the manner of the Gentiles, why tell Gentiles that they have to live after the manner of the Jews? Isn't that exactly the same thing that Paul was telling Peter? Except they were Jews. Now, as a saved, born-again Christian, we are to stand fast in liberty of Jesus Christ, and not to confuse the gospel of Christ for lost souls. Any form of works inserted into the gospel of Jesus Christ will pollute and corrupt the gospel of grace, damning the lost soul whose trust in some form of work, who does not avail himself of salvation of God's grace, which is by grace through faith, plus or minus nothing. Galatians 5:1. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. Now see, what we're dealing with here is one of the parts of the Jewish law, and we're dealing with this issue of circumcision. Now, I had a Christian ask me, well, should I circumcise my son or my children? And I told him, it's a tradition that Gentiles have followed through, but if you do it in any way in regards to salvation, you're gonna damn your soul. You're going to confuse your son. Now, if you want to do it because you think it's something to do that's right to do as a Christian, it's okay, but it's got nothing to do with salvation. And here you're dealing with somebody, here you're dealing with the issue right on the grounds of salvation. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit nothing. You see, the minute that you do something outside of complete and total trust in Christ, Christ becomes worthless to you. You understand that? Once anything else is in there, it's not the Christ of the Bible. It's another gospel. And Jesus Christ becomes worthless to you. He cannot save you because it's not him. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to do the whole law. The minute that you try to do one part of the law for salvation, you are obligated to the entire law for salvation. So if you're going to do circumcision, you got to keep the Sabbath. If you're going to do the Sabbath, you got to keep circumcision. If you do the Sabbath and circumcision, you're going to end up back slaughtering lambs. You can't get away with part of the law. If you're going to keep the law, the whole law has got to be kept. That means you're going to have to keep the full ceremonial law. You're going to have to keep the full civil law, and you're going to have to keep the full moral law. They don't even know what they are. I mean, most Christians don't even know what they are. And the other thing is this. Those Jews could never keep them. They had to trust in the blood on the altar, and that's gone because it had to be shed only in Jerusalem. You can't put an altar up in Syracuse, New York, and put some lamb's blood on it. It had to be in Jerusalem. We'll get to that in a minute. Christ has become no effect unto you. Whosoever you are justified by the law, you are fallen from grace. You see that? If you try to justify by the law, you're fallen from grace. For we, through the Spirit, wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith, which worketh by love. Now ye did run well, who did hinder you? So that's what I would say to this lady. All right, if you're saved by grace and faith, and you're trusting the shed blood of Christ, well, who hindered you? Where'd you pick up this need to keep the law? That you should not obey the truth. This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. A little leaven loveth the whole lump. Because, ma'am, if you want to keep the law, you got to keep the whole thing. Now, what the Seventh-day Adventists teach is that Constantine changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. And, of course, with them, that's the mark of the beast. And they're very anti-Catholic. And I told her, I says, well, the Catholic Church has been teaching salvation by works for centuries. That's a great error, so I don't have a problem agreeing you on that. But you need to be saved by grace through faith. Now, here's the question. Did Constantine change the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday as taught by the Seventh-day Adventists and corrupt Christianity with the mark of the beast? Probably not. The honest answer is, it's not likely. In the year 321 A.D., Constantine decreed, on the vernal day of the sun, let the magistrates and people residing in the cities rest, and let all workshops be closed. And that can be checked by Codex Justinianus, Philip Schaff, Church History. He's a Catholic historian. Constantine made this change himself. Now, this is very important to understand history in its context. One more time, time and judgment. He did not do it through the papacy, since the papacy had not really come into being at that time. The papacy grew gradually out of the office of the Bishop of Rome, established by the groundwork of Constantine, who was baptized for salvation, making baptismal regeneration the bedrock foundation of Roman Catholic doctrine. It's a works for salvation. What the Catholic Church believes in is baptismal regeneration. They believe you're born again when you get baptized. Ask any Catholic priest that knows his doctrines. And that's what Constantine did. He waited till his deathbed to get baptized on to save himself so he could live like a rascal until he was going to check out. And then he called for someone to baptize him. That's why you have a tradition in Catholicism when somebody gets close to death, somebody goes and gives them the last rites and anoints them with oil. See, these things all connect. Titus says, but after that, the kindness and love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us, by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that being justified by his grace, we should be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. For many centuries, the erring bishops of Rome have taught salvation through works outside of complete and total justification by faith. This was the great schism that developed in the Reformation, particularly with Luther and the popes. Luther's position was salvation was by grace plus nothing. And this is what the position of all the saved reformers was. Justification by faith plus nothing. Now, Christians, going back to the Acts of the Apostles, always held that position. In any case, it should be noted that in doing this, Constantine was not changing the Sabbath, which is of Jewish covenant. He was merely making Sunday the official day of rest and worship for the Roman Empire, and it was very likely he was following the traditions of the apostles and early Christians. You say, where do you get that from? It's well documented that the early church adopted Sunday as their day of worship. Take your Bible and turn to Acts chapter 20, verse 7. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached on them to depart on the morrow and continued his speech until midnight. On the first day of the week, the day of the resurrection, the apostles and disciples, who were Christians, came together to break bread and fellowship. It would be natural for the disciples to meet on Sunday for their worship, since it is the very day that our Lord and Savior rose from the dead. Look at Mark chapter 16, verse 9. Now when Jesus was risen early the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had cast seven devils. The apostles confirmed this tradition with the taking up of the offering on the first day of the week. 1 Corinthians 16:2, upon the first day of the week, let every one of you lay by him in store, as God hath prospered him, that there be no gatherings when I come. So you've got the Lord rising from the dead on Sunday, the first day of the week, following the Sabbath, Saturday, the seventh day of the week. You've got the fellowship of the apostles on the first day of the week, and you've got the offering on the first day of the week. The early church was meeting on Sunday, the first day of the week, to worship God. Now, here you get into a thing that a lot of Christians do. It's a humanistic thing to do. It's a wrong thing to do. What people do is they see somebody's action, and they make a judgment. Okay. I'm not going to put that in my mouth because I don't know whose it is. I might do it at home, but here's a pencil, okay? How many of you are eraser eaters? Yeah. How many of you don't want to admit that, huh? Okay. Just pretend I'm eating the eraser. Oh, why did I do it? I could have done it because I liked the taste of the eraser. I could have done it because I was hungry. I could have done it because I was nervous and jerky and didn't have anything else to do. You see, there's a multitude of reasons why people do things. Are you with me? And you sit there thinking you know why people did things, you're nuts. Because people do all kinds of strange things for all kinds of strange reasons. That's what you need to realize. Judge not, lest you be judged. Because you don't know what's going on. See, that's why I tell you, I don't know who's saved or who's lost. I know what you tell me. I know what the doctrines are. If you totally trusted Christ by faith, by faith through grace, you're saved. Okay? And I'll believe you. This woman told me she's saved. So I talked to her as a Christian. Now, I'm concerned because she's hanging on to a part of the Old Testament law, and I'll show you that in a few minutes. But I can't do anything but tell her the truth. All right, Constantine's motivation was probably not born out of hatred for the Jews as taught by the Seventh-day Adventists. It's hard to say for sure why Constantine or any historical figure did what they did. I mean, here's a good one for especially Confederates down south. Robert E. Lee. Everybody believes he's the best general in the Civil War. Everybody. Any good general. I'm not even a military person, and I know you never attack head-on when you can make a flanking maneuver that will achieve the objective. The Confederacy was winning the battle at Gettysburg by flanking maneuvers. For some reason, the only thing I can say it's pride, Lee decided he'd put on a full frontal assault and he was going to just break the Union and defeat them. So he sent 6,000 men across a mile and a half of open terrain going uphill. That is the poorest generalship you ever get in generaling. That's not the way you move an army. I know that. And I'm just a pastor in a pulpit. And he's supposed to have been the greatest general that ever lived in the Civil War. He probably was. He lost the whole Civil War on that one day, on that one foolish thing he did. Why did he do it? He probably asked himself, why did I do that? It's hard to say for sure why Constantine or any historical figure did what they did, but it's most likely that out of a desire to adopt what the Christians had practiced for nearly 2.5 centuries, he made his decree desiring to Christianize his kingdom. These passages we have read clearly indicate that the Christians were meeting regularly on Sunday, the first day of the week. John chapter 20, verse 19, I'll give you another verse. Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus, stood in the midst, and said unto them, peace be unto you. So if they were meeting on the wrong day of the week, wouldn't the Lord have come in and said, gentlemen, you're supposed to be meeting on Saturday, not Sunday? He'd come in and said, peace be unto you. It would be natural and proper for early Christians to meet on Sunday, as it is the day of the Lord's resurrection from the dead. One more time. Matthew 28:1. And in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to draw toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. Further, it would have been very practical and proper practice or tradition to meet on Sunday after dealing with the Jews on the Sabbath day. All right, Acts 18:4, and this tells you about Paul. And he reasoned in the synagogues every Sabbath and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. So Paul was going, and the early apostles were going on the Sabbath. They were going to the synagogues, and they were trying to convert the Jews. Now they didn't have time to worship. So for them to get together to have their fellowship, they couldn't have fellowship in a place that's hotly contested. You have fellowship where you're breaking bread and all in agreement, sitting together as one man. See? The Apostle Paul and disciples could not worship on the Sabbath with the Jews when they were in the temple. The gospel of grace of Jesus Christ was in complete contrast to the covenant of the Jews with the Sabbath as the center of their worship. Acts 19:8. And he went into the synagogue and spake boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. The Sabbath observance is part of the Jewish covenant, and it belongs to the Jewish people as part of their covenant with God. Look at Exodus chapter 31, verse 16. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations. Watch what it says. For a perpetual covenant. All right? The Jews, the Sabbath belongs to the Jews. Keeping the Sabbath is a central part of keeping in the covenant. Exodus 16, 22. And it came to pass that on the sixth day they gathered twice as much bread, two omers for one man, and all the rulers of the congregation came and told Moses. And he said unto them, this is that which the Lord has said. Tomorrow is the rest of the holy Sabbath unto the Lord. Bake that which ye will bake today, and seed that ye will seed, and that which remaineth over lay up for you to be kept until the morning. And they laid it up until the morning, as Moses bade, and it did not stink, neither was there any worm therein. And Moses said, eat that today, for today is a Sabbath unto the Lord. Today ye shall not find it in the field. 6 days ye shall gather it, but on the seventh day, which is a Sabbath, in it there shall be none. And it came to pass that there went out some of the people on the Sabbath day for to gather, and they found none. And the Lord said unto Moses, how long refuse ye to keep my commandments and my laws? See, for that the Lord hath given you the Sabbath. The Lord gave the Sabbath to the Jew. Therefore he giveth you on 6 days the bread of 2 days. Abide ye every man in his place. Let no man go out of his place on the seventh day. So the people rested on the seventh day. Very simple. It's Jewish. Now, the things you want to realize, this was the Jewish covenant. What did Jesus tell us? That we'd have a new covenant. So we're not in that Jewish covenant. New Testament has a new covenant. Sabbath observance was also set by worship in Jerusalem. Look at Deuteronomy 12, 13. Take heed to thyself that thou offer not thy burnt offerings in every place that thou seest, but in the place which the Lord shall choose in one of thy tribes. There thou shalt offer thy burnt offerings, and there thou shalt do all that I command thee. They could not offer their offerings anywhere they wanted when they came under law with Moses. They had to do it where God specified. The sacrifices could only be offered in Jerusalem, so the Sabbath was set by Jerusalem and not by the world's time. Nehemiah 1:8. Now, yes, and I'll be honest with you, so I know the scriptures. They first offered their sacrifices in Shiloh. That's where the Lord first put his name, and then he moved it to Jerusalem. But once he moved it to Jerusalem, there was only one place. And that's been perpetual since then. Here we go. Remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant, Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out unto the uttermost part of heaven, yet will I gather them from thence, and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Jerusalem, city of the great king. Meeting on the first day of the week was instituted by the disciples themselves and confirmed by the Lord. So it would make sense that a tradition of Sunday worship would follow Jewish disciples that would contend with the Jews on the Sabbath day. They would fellowship with each other on the first day of the week, which was Sunday, starting the tradition that most Christians still follow today. And I say most Christians, saved and lost professing Christians. In order to be a saved Christian, you must be born again. Okay. A lot of people say they're Christians that are not Christian. If you don't have a spiritual birth, you're not a Christian. If Christ is not dwelling in you, you're not a Christian. The Bible's clear. Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle. Now, I just gave you about 6 different verses that show you that the early church in the Bible were meeting on Sunday, the first day of the week, not on the Sabbath. It is important to remember that corporate worship with other believers is necessary and part of obedience to the Lord Jesus Christ. But the day that your church body chooses to worship on is not legally obligatory under the grace of the gospel. We do it by principle and tradition. I'm not going to die and go to hell if I was to worship on Monday. In fact, guess what? Today is Wednesday. So if Constantine had the mark of the beast by starting church services on Sunday, who was the individual that got us on Wednesday? And what mark is this? I mean, the Bible only deals with Saturday and Sunday. You still got to come back next week. I'll be here. But it's got nothing to do with your salvation. Okay? It is important to remember that corporate worship, Hebrews, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. The New Testament addresses this in a couple of different passages. And you being dead in your sins and non-circumcision of your flesh, this is Colossians 2:13, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Let no man therefore judge you in meat, or in drink, or in respect of a holy day, or of the new moon, or of Sabbath days. Now, I'm going to let you in on something that the Seventh-day Adventists don't know. I don't think a lot of them know. And they're always trying to trip up dumb Christians by saying, well, the Sunday's not the Sabbath. Don't you know that? I know that. But I'm going to tell you something. Saturday isn't the only Sabbath. There's a whole bunch of other Sabbaths in the Old Testament besides Saturday. Every one of the major feasts was a Sabbath, all seven of them. Well, you know, these Jehovah's Witnesses, no, not Jehovah's Witnesses, I'm getting confused. Seventh-day Adventists, they're trying to be Jews. Everybody tries to be Jews and take the promises of the Jew, and you're not going to get it unless you're a Jew. And even the Jew can't get the promise of the Jews right now because God isn't dealing with his people anymore. And he won't until the tribulation. All right, let's underline verse 16. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or of a new moon or the Sabbath days. Now, go back to why you should be here on Wednesday night. It has nothing to do with getting saved, going to heaven. So you can learn something about the 700,080 words in that Bible. Now, see, I knew how to deal with her. I also knew, well, a lot of young people don't, I talked to her for just a few minutes and ended the conversation. I didn't turn it into a bloodbath and a nightmare fighting with her in a soul-winning booth where we're trying to win souls. And I also talked to her very kindly and sincerely, hoping to win her soul. Now, I'll be honest with you, I enjoyed talking to her a lot better than I did that other woman last year. I thought the other one was going to conk me with her. I wouldn't want to say it because I don't want to take anything off the tape, but with her religious artifact, I thought she was going to conk me in the head with it. This lady was at least nice about it, and she was inquiring, not so much as trying to trick me up. All right. The Lord Jesus Christ canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect to holy day or of a new moon or of the Sabbath days. Now, I've said that to you three times. I haven't gotten senile. There's a reason I said it to you three times. I hope you took the time to underline it in your Bible and get it in your brain so that you're not supposed to let somebody mess you up with things like, have you kept the Sabbath? Which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. Let no man beguile you of your reward in voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding those things which he hath not seen. Now watch it, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. The flesh is always looking for something to do to justify itself before God. Especially lost people. When you die tonight, you're going to heaven or you're going to hell?
Oh, I don't know.
You don't know? Well, I guess I'm going to heaven. Why? Well, I'm a good person. I haven't murdered anybody. No, they probably committed who knows how many sins. People think if they don't commit the big 4 or 5, they're not sinners. There's 613 laws to be violated under the law. And even in the Big Ten, the Decalogue, that's a lot more than 5. And you've got people that don't know anything about their Bible just taking these positions with their soul's damnation. I'm okay. I'm okay, preacher. If you don't have Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're not okay. You're destined for a devil's hell. And then they get mad at you for telling the truth. Have I become your enemy because I tell you the truth? There is no other name given under heaven whereas by ye must be saved. All right, Romans 14:1. Now, that was nice. Look at what it says. Him that is weak in the faith, receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Now, that's me today. I used to eat all things. Now I'm eating herbs. I don't know if that's good or bad, but that's the way it is. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not. And let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth. For God hath received him. I just like to eat some more, but I can't. Who art thou that... I'm kidding. I'm talking about my weight loss. I'm talking about my starvation for the last 2 years, you know. Okay. Who art thou to judge another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth. Now, see, I didn't tell this lady she was damned on her way to hell. I told her, I said, if you're truly saved by grace through faith, and you want to go on Sabbath, you got liberty. But I told her, I said, but if you're trusting in that in any way, shape, or form to get to heaven, they'll send you to hell. That's what I told her. Yea, he should be holding up, for God is able to make him stand. One man esteemeth one day above another, another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto the Lord. And he that regardeth not the day to the Lord, he doth not regard it. He that eateth to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks. And he that eateth not to the Lord, eateth not and giveth God thanks. For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself. So see, we can come on Wednesday. For whether we live, we live unto the Lord, and whether we die unto the Lord. Whether we live therefore or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ both died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and living. But why dost thou judge thy brother, or why dost thou set at naught thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Now here's the only thing that's the problem, and I live with it for 30 years, and it's not a major problem. But here's what happens. See, you're being taught regularly. And tonight, there's less than what there is on other nights. Probably a lot of people went worked the fair and everything. They figured they put out a hard task, and they're busy. And so, like, well, tonight, I'll get there next Wednesday night. Well, here's the thing. This lady shows up with her false doctrine. You ain't going to know how to answer. And they could get confused and stumble because they didn't take the time, Lord. That's why we have services on Wednesday night. Bible study to learn. Okay, we are not to be subject to men in respect to the Sabbath day. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does it so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. Galatians 2:12. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles. But when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were the circumcision. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas was also carried away with their dissimulation. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, If thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? So, ma'am, if you watch this, why are you compelling Gentiles to live as the Jews? It's not correct. Now, we are not to be subject to men in respect to Sabbath days. For he is not a Jew. Now, here, everybody should turn here, and we'll close with this. This is important. Romans chapter 2, verse 28. For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly. Neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh. But he is a Jew which is one inwardly, and circumcision that is of the heart, in the spirit, watch, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. Biblical New Testament Christians meet on the first day of the week in grace, in the love of Jesus Christ, who rose from the dead on Sunday, the first day of the week, and not on the Sabbath, Saturday, in the letter of the law. Any questions? Now, you should be able to give an answer to any Seventh-day Adventist. Now, it's my personal opinion without knowledge, but as it looks to me, most Seventh-day Adventists are lost people because they're trusting in the Sabbath as part of their justification to God. If they're doing that, they're damned. The Seventh-day Adventists are, from what I can determine, the closest of any group that I know of to true Christianity without being Christian, because the only thing they're sticking out there, but it's enough to send to hell, is keeping the Sabbath. Now, if you were truly saved, and you wanted to meet on Saturday, you can. But for what? The minute that you start trying to prove something, you're starting to get into heresy, because you're proving something contrary to the gospel of grace. But you have the grace to meet on Saturday if you want. Does that make sense to you? Any questions? All right, but what you want to take in severe gravity is God that technical? He is. He's that technical because if you put any trust in anything other than the shed blood of Christ, you're not, Christ will profit you nothing. You understand that? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege to be Christians. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your blessings. Thank you for all that we have and joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Even in death he remembered the thief hanging by his side. He spoke with love and compassion. Then he took him to no fear.